they are able to print that fake currency there. Then because of the fact that the India-Nepal border is an open border, it is a porous border, so they are able to smuggle that currency into India. And then they give it to these Naxalites. And what these Naxalites do is that whatever legal currency they generate through the other sources, they mix that legal currency with the fake currency and then circulate it in the market. We, ironically, had tried to tackle this way back in 2016 when the government carried out that exercise called demonetization. But the problem was that this demonetization exercise also could not help these particular things to be curtailed. भाई वो डिमोनेटाइजेशन जब हुआ था उस टाइम पे वो बड़ी बड़ी बातें होती थी कि जी वो सरकार ने नया नोट निकाला है 2000 रुपए का, वो 2000 के नोट में जो है वो चिप लगी हुई है, वो नोट ऐसा है कि मतलब ऐसा डिजाइन किया है कि वो नोट में कोई करप्शन करेगा तो वो जो बापू बाहर आके थप्पड़ मार देगा। आपने सुना होगा, ये सब बकवास था भाई, पूरा स्कैम था वो, वेल डिजाइन स्कैम। आप इस चीज को समझने की कोशिश करो, डिमोनेटाइजेशन 2016 में हुआ, 2014 से जब से ये सरकार आई इसने 2 साल पहले क्या किया, इन्होंने पहले जनधन योजना के अकाउंट खुलवाए। आप समझ रहे हो, यू सी अंडरस्टैंड द प्रोसेस। फॉर फर्स्ट 2 ईयर्स यू लेट द पीपल ओपन बैंक अकाउंट्स, लैक्स ऑफ बैंक अकाउंट्स, देन यू डिमोनेटाइज द मनी, देन यू से दैट यू डिपॉजिट द वट एवर वेल्थ यू हैव इन दोज बैंक अकाउंट्स एंड अप टू 2 लाख रुपीज देयर इज गोइंग टू बी नो इन्वेस्टिगेशन। Up to 2 lakh rupees if you deposit, income tax will never send you a notice. See the beauty, sir. Lakhs of accounts, 2 lakh rupees in all accounts. That's why the RBI said in the report, 99% currency came back. Question is, what did you achieve? And the fact of the matter is that the RBI report is false. You speak to any person in the RBI, if you are proximate and close to him, he will tell you the reality. The reality is that 101% currency came back. And the reason why 101% currency came back during the demonetization exercise was that 1% surplus was basically the fake currency, which these Naxalites took advantage of the exercise of demonetization and deposited that money in the banking system. Because in those 40-day period of the demonetization, the bankers who were taking and accepting the cash never had the time, energy, motivation to identify that the money which is being deposited is fake or genuine. They were just taking the money and depositing. And then when the RBI counted, they realized 16,400 crore is demonetized, 17,000 crore came back. How is it possible? RBI said ki itni economics to humne nahi padhi thi, hum Gujarat mein padh li isi. So one thing became very clear, sir, that even during that exercise of demonetization, if you try to recollect, one very important development that happened ironically was 8th November 2016, demonetization was announced. And surprisingly, 11th November, 3 days later, the chief of the intelligence bureau met the prime minister and told him that the 2000 rupee fake currency notes have been pumped by the ISI in the Indian market today. And during the process of demonetization, try to recollect, we always used to get this information that fake currency notes are going on in the market. We could not tackle it. Let's accept it. It was a failure. So the fact of the matter is that the ISI of Pakistan gave them fake currency, that money is now in the banking system. That is why today you see one very important thing is, intelligence bureau is of the opinion, 80% of the Naxalite money is already in the banks. 20% of the money held by the Naxalites is in the form of bullion, gold, silver, etc. Anyway, Indians have a affinity for a dead metal called gold. So Naxalites took advantage. Maximum affinity for a dead metal called gold is today visible in the eastern UP, Bihar and South India. 20% of the money they possess is in the form of bullion today. 80% is already deposited, whatever they have money generated over a period of time, into what is called as the formal financial system called the banks. And you cannot do anything about it. They use what is called as so-called, you know, legal money, generated through all illegal sources. This is a classical example of money laundering. Then apart from this, they have urban sympathizers. Who are primarily intellectuals. Who are in the urban areas, people who are frustrated by life, They often become intellectuals in the society. And they have a complete nexus in the urban areas to generate sympathy for the Maoist cause, generate financial monetary support provided to the rural areas. So there is a constant movement of money that happens, which is generated from the urban area and flows to the rural area. Urban sympathizers play a very important role in this. Now, keeping this in mind, the document we found was basically of 2007. And the document said that target for 2007 was 150 crores. The document that we just found, where we all found these sources, it stated that the party wants to generate 150 crores in 2007 as a target. Now this is a very important thing, sir, because if the party wanted to generate as a target of 150 crore in 2007, that proves one thing, that in 2006 they must have generated around 120, 130 crores. And only on the principle of incrementalism will you go a little above and go for this kind of a target. And thereby, based on these sources, today the Intelligence Bureau is of the opinion that in 2018, party could have targeted to raise around 350 to 400 crores. Inflation adjusted. So 350 to 400 crores is a huge amount of money. If that was the target for 2018, it's a huge amount of money for these people to basically carry out these activities. So these are only the known sources which are there in the document. There could be more unknown sources, but at least these known sources are prominent as such. Keeping this in mind, let's have a look at the government strategy to tackle the LWE. Any question, any doubt anywhere till now? Any question, clarification? Anyone who is happy with IAS officer? One who doesn't become certainly is never happy in life. One who becomes is also not happy because he never got a cadet of his choice, a wife of his choice, etc. Who is happy? Huh? No, it's not necessarily in this case, because these people have some deep-rooted grievances rather than just mere unhappiness. So normally people in Bengal who are unhappy, they beat the IAS IPS officer. So Bengal has this culture, you know. That's why nobody in the IAS IPS ever wants to go for Bengal cadre. It's a punishment cadre in your life. So unhappiness is not the concern for them. They have grievances, they explain them that these are our grievances. These people have been depriving us of whatever benefits that were to be given to the poor, thereby we target them. So they have a logical explanation. But obviously you are targeting the people of the state, so which is anyway an illegal activity. But they explain why they do. So that is why we say that it is a properly well-defined movement that they do. So we can't attribute it only to the fact that there is unhappiness. All these things, you know, what you said is important, because, you know, normally our friend here says a very important thing. I wanted somebody to ask this question. You get these names like Ganpati and all in the newspapers that they are the leaders. They are all names promoted by front organizations. Now they are not officially names announced ever by the CPI Maoist. So front organizations, they carry out this propaganda by deliberately coming out with names of the leaders, only to confuse the entire, you know, the intellectual citizenry of the country, and also confuse the government by doing this. But officially, till the time CPI Maoist does not announce that this person is our leader, we do not accept it. So it's a good propaganda. Front organizations are pioneers in doing that. So let them do that. No issues. Relation between CPI Maoist and China not there, sir. Relation between CPI Marxist, China completely there. People of CPI Marxist are people who take money from China. Ye Prakash Karat, Brinda Karat, inko sadak pe lage pito hai inko. China se paisa khate, India mein rehte, India ko gali dete. Inko to China ke line of actual control pe le jaake na, wahan se dhakka maar dena chahiye, pehnwaoge. Dubad dubad ke maro inko. But CPI Maoist ka koi nexus nahi hai, Marxist ka zarur hai. और मार्क्सिस्ट का इंटेलिजेंस ब्यूरो को पता भी है, और इंटेलिजेंस ब्यूरो इसीलिए आप देख लो कि पूरी सीपीआई मार्क्सिस्ट को इंटरनली तोड़ रही है। आज की डेट में आप अभी चलो 2019 में तो जनरल इलेक्शन है, आगे कल को स्टेट इलेक्शन भी होंगे। सीपीआई मार्क्सिस्ट का पॉलिटिकल बेस खत्म हो रहा है, इंटेलेक्चुअल बेस रहेगा, वो जो पागल इंटेलेक्चुअल है जिनको लाइफ में वैसे कोई काम नहीं, लेफ्टिस्ट हो जाते हैं, जाके पढ़ना लिखना होता ही नहीं उनको तो वैसे भी। बट एनी वे द सीपीआई माओइस्ट हैज नो सच नेक्सस व्हिच हैज बीन प्रूवन टिल टुडे। चाइनीज वेपनरी इज नेवर फाउंडेड सर, the weaponry is always the Indian weaponry manufactured basically in India only used by the Indian forces, 95% is looted away, they don't use any other foreign weaponry till now, it's mostly looted away or self manufactured, that is the idea. Any other issue? Nahi sir, these rebellions initially which are there, they were all isolated, you know, separate incidents. But considering the fact that most of these incidents happened because of the concern for the poor, tribal and, you know, for the purpose of land, we attribute it broadly under the movement called Naxalite, but it is not proper to do that. So these incidents have to be seen as isolated sporadic incidents only. Any other issues? Any question, clarification anyway? So we have a look at the government strategy. So as far as the government strategy is concerned, initially when the problem began in 1969, government adopted a, you know, security centric strategy. In the security centric strategy, counter violence was the approach adopted. So in the security-centric strategy, you know, Naxalites are doing violence, police is doing counter-violence. Two things that we can use to justify this, which we have seen what happened in Srikakulam, what happened in Operation Steeplechase. So both these operations, the one carried out by the police in Srikakulam and the subsequent Steeplechase after the Cultural Revolution, both signify the strategy of the government called counter-violence to the violence orchestrated by these extremists. But you know, even if this strategy continued, the problem is that we were not able to understand that why these people do violence. And that is why it was sometime between 95 to 2000 that a lot of studies happened. Between 1995 to 2000, a lot of studies happened to find out that why these people are doing violence. Most of these studies were sponsored by the government officially. People associated with studies were government servants only. They tried to identify by visiting these areas to know that why these people are doing violence. These studies, they basically prepared reports, and all these reports pointed out that the reason why these people are doing violence is because of poverty, unemployment, backwardness in these areas. So most of these studies, they pointed out that the reason why these people do violence is because these areas are backward, they have poverty, they have unemployment. And most of the people who were associated with these studies, they told the government that it is not a security centric problem that you are thinking of till now. It is a problem that basically is because of lack of development. So most of these studies basically tried to tell the government that it is important for the government to address the developmental gaps. And as most of these studies told the government to address the developmental gaps, the government accepted the recommendations. And in 2003, the government brought about a shift from security centric to a new development come security centric strategy. So since 2003, we have been adopting what is called as a development come security centric strategy. And under this development come security centric strategy today, there are various government initiatives that have been launched. which are exclusive to these areas over and above the normal developmental initiatives that are carried out. So you can write down few lines. The approach of the government. Is to holistically address the problem of extremism. The strategy adopted tries to holistically focus upon areas of security, development, rights and entitlements of local communities, rights and entitlements of local communities, improvement in governance, and public perception management. In dealing with this decades-old problem, it has been felt appropriate after various high-level deliberations and interactions with the concerned state governments that an integrated approach targeted at a specific area shall deliver better results. Appropriately, the government has identified eleven states and 90 districts to tackle the problem. The government has formulated a national policy and action plan which has adopted a multidisciplinary approach in 2017. The government adopted an umbrella scheme. Known as the modernization of police forces scheme. It has various sub schemes under it. which include number one, security related expenditure scheme. Security related expenditure scheme. In the 11 affected states, the central government reimburses to the state governments security related expenditure. Security related expenditure related to training and operational needs of the security forces. The aim of the scheme is to strengthen the capacity of the affected states to fight the problem. Second, special central assistance for 30 most affected districts. 30 most affected districts as a sub scheme. Its objective is to fill the critical gaps in public infrastructure and services, in the affected areas, in 2018-19, 775 crores have been allocated for this sub scheme. Third, special infrastructure scheme. It aims to create security specific infrastructure in the affected areas. It aims to establish village level security infrastructure through village defense committees. Village defense committees, and also aims to establish ...400 police stations in 10 states as of 2018. 393 police stations have been established. Next, assistance to central agencies for LWE management scheme. Assistance to central agencies for LWE management scheme in the affected areas. The Central Armed Police Forces provide assistance to the state police for carrying out ground operations. Under the scheme, the central government provides assistance to central police forces, for strengthening infrastructure and hiring charges for helicopters. Next, Civic Action Program. Was launched in 2010-11. Which aims to bridge the gaps between the security forces and the local police. In the affected areas, the perception of the people is that the security forces are suppressive in nature. The scheme aims to address the perceptual gap. It encourages the police to carry out certain civic functions. Related to the welfare of the people, which would eventually bring the police closer to the people. Next, Media Management Scheme. In the affected areas, the extremists have carried out an aggressive propaganda amongst the tribals and the youth. To carry out a revolution. The government is trying to mainstream the misguided youth and the tribals. The misguided youth and the tribals.